Thank you very much, Susan. This is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Mary-Lou Chanel, who is the Director of Clinical Pharmacokinetic and Pharmacometric at Serbia. She obtained her PhD in Pharmacy in 2000 from University of Paris Descartes, and she obtained her PhD in Modeling and Simulation, PKPD Modeling, in 2003. Then she did a postdoc with Professor Leon Aron in University of Manchester, in UK, on optimal design. She has published more than 20 papers in modeling and simulations, and she has supervised doctoral students. Mary-Lou is welcome to today's event, and we are eager to hear your presentation. Over to you.
Okay. So hello everyone, and thank you, Masoud, for this introduction. And I would like also to thank Amin Rostami and Suzanne for giving me today the opportunity to make this webinar. So today I'm going to talk about PBPK prediction and optimal design approach to design study during drug development. As you know, better designing studies is certainly a key factor for success in drug development. So the objective of this webinar is just to share with you what we do at Servier to design studies, especially when involving PK assessment. And it's not going to be at all a formal lecture, but more a means to share experience. And just two words about Servier. So Servier is a French independent middle-sized company with about 20,000 people over the world. And its R&D is mainly in cardiology, oncology, CNS, metabolism, and rheumatology. So here is where you can find me, so my email address. And I've got also a LinkedIn profile. So regarding the agenda today, so I'm going to start first with some background and the rationale to use PBPK to design a clinical trial. And then I will go through two case studies, one in pediatrics, and actually you will see that it's two examples, and one about drug-drug interaction. So my feeling today is that pharmacometricians in pharma companies, or at least in a survey, are seen as a mix of someone with mathematical or computational skills who likes playing with complex equations and software, and a tinkerbell who can be consulted when the study fails. However, as Fisher, the famous statistician, said, to consult the statistician after an experiment is finished is often merely to ask him to conduct a post-mortem examination. He can perhaps say what the experiment died of. Indeed, the design of the study that you plan to conduct is essential in the success of your trial. And not only the number of subjects to be included, as very often the clinician believes, but many variables of your design, as for instance, the study duration, the time of the measurement of the dose. And also, it is obvious, it seems to be often forgotten. The study design has to be designed according to the study objective. So for instance, if you want to learn about the dose exposure response, you need to investigate a large range of doses. In the good practice paper in Model Informed Drug Discovery and Development from the ESPE MID3 work group, which has been recently published in CPT-PSP, the importance of study design when aiming to analyze data by modeling is clearly underlined. So two words about this paper, which is a follow-up of the EMA workshop organized in London in 2011. So this good practice paper has been written by representatives of about 10 pharma companies and is organized in three sections. So the first one is about why MID3 is important for decision makers. And in this part, there is a review of published applications across drug discovery, development, and lifecycle management. and a summary of collated business value. The second part is about what MID3 means for practitioners. We need to understand the premise and apply methodology and strategy. And the last part is about how MID3 should be conducted with, for instance, the level and type of documentation. And in this paper, there is an extensive review of literature focusing on MID3 application and their value to R&D. And one category is about study design optimization. And this paper is in free access in TPTPSP, and I recommend you to read it. So the objective of optimal design approach is to be able to estimate as precisely as possible the parameters of a mathematical model. And this model should be the one that you are going to use to analyze the data in order to draw correct conclusions and to inform decision making. And the estimate precision of the parameters of the model depends on the study design. So to choose the study design, you can either do it empirically, but you risk to collect uninformative data, especially when the model is complex and the time sampling time selection is not straightforward. It can be done through clinical trial simulation, but it can be time consuming, or it can be done through optimal design approach based on the Fisher information matrix. What do you need to optimize your design? So on one hand, you need to know the mathematical model and its parameters describing the response. The response being, for instance, the concentration over time, the PD measurement, or can be even both. And in this latter case, we use the terminology multi-response. And this model is supposed to be the one you are going to use to analyze the data. And on the other end, you need to define the study variables. And for instance, the study variables can be the number of subjects, the number of sampling time, the study constraints, like the period during which you can make some measurements. And then you can estimate the population Fisher information matrix in respect of your model and your design. Mathematically, as a consequence of the Kramer-Rao inequality, the inverse of the Fisher information matrix is the lower bound of the estimation variance matrix. And due to the nonlinearity of the model, especially in PK, the Fisher information matrix has to be approximated. And this approximation is hopefully implemented in different software. So as a consequence of Kramer-Rao inequality, minimizing the variance of estimates is equivalent to maximizing the Fisher information matrix. So it means to determine the design variables that will maximize a criterion. These design variables can be the number of samples, the sampling time, the number of subjects allocated to each sampling design. So several optimization criteria have been proposed, and the d-optimality is the one which is commonly used, and it consists in maximizing the determinant of the Fisher information matrix. And to maximize the determinant of the Fisher information matrix, several optimization algorithms are available, such as the simplex, the federal-free, or the simulated annealing. So optimal design approaches are often seen as a sophisticated approach developed by smart academic persons, but only used by few pharmacometricians in pharma companies. And this is one of the reasons why at the beginning of the DDMOR project, we have run a survey about the current use and development needed for optimal design in pharmacometrics. So at the start of the DDMOR project, 10 pharma companies were involved. There are now 11, and 9 out of the 10 answered to the survey. And in this table are the results of the 9 companies. So most of the EFPA use optimal design approach to optimize or evaluate the design, and 2/3 use optimal design approach for power evaluation. And in terms of complexity of designs, optimal design approaches are mainly used to determine sampling windows or to determine several groups of sampling times, and at last to optimize those. And in case you've never heard about DDMOR, so DDMOR stands for Drug Disease Model Resources, and DDMOR is an innovative medicine initiative project from EU, which has started 5 years ago, involving 11 EFPA, several academic groups, and SME in Europe. And the objective of DDMOR project is, of course, to deliver some products. So the first product is a model repository allowing to access to curated and share knowledge. The second product is an interoperability framework allowing to bridge modeling tools and methodology. And the third product is a workflow in pharmacometrics allowing to automate and improve modeling process. And there is also a work package about training to support adoption of DDMOR product, and a work package for new tools development. So to apply the optimal design approach, several tools are available, and these tools have been compared in a paper published in the British Journal of Clinical Pharmacology. And if you are interested to learn more about what they offer, you can read this paper. So one of the requirements to apply optimal design approach is the need to know in advance the model and its parameters that you are going to use to analyze the data of the study that you want to design. Thanks to their physiological nature, PDPK models are appropriate to perform extrapolation and therefore could be used as a priori knowledge when no data are available in a particular population or in new conditions that have never been studied. So SimSip is a software that we are using in routine at Servier for PDPK, and I'm not going to elaborate so much here on the capability of SimSip, as I imagine that people who listen to this webinar are familiar with it. And on this slide, it's just my personal view of SimSip, a population-based IDMA simulator made of three components. So a system component, which is a generic PDPK framework, a drug component, where you can fill in information about the drug of interest, so for instance, the physicochemical properties, the in vitro data, and so on. And a design component allowing you to perform Monte Carlo simulation using the PDPK model and information about the study design and the population. So the idea is to perform PDPK prediction to generate a priori information in a condition that has never been studied, knowing that the PDPK model should be, of course, qualified for this purpose, and then to develop a classical comportamental PopPK model using the PDPK prediction, as in general data are analyzed by PopPK, and finally to optimize the sampling times using the PopPK model with using the PDPK prediction. So at Servier, we use SimSip to make the PDPK prediction. We use software like NodeMail, Monolix to build the PopPK model, but it can be done with Phoenix and LME. And for optimal design, we use PayFim and PopDesk, but other software are also available. And as you can anticipate, one of the difficulties of such strategy is the need to know several tools, several software, which could be solved thanks to the DDMOR project, which aims at developing a framework allowing interoperability between software. So now I'm going to illustrate with case studies. And the first one is about ivabradin and its development in fillers. So ivabradin is a true arthrite-reducing agent and a selective inhibitor of the cardiac pacemaker if current in the sinus node. In EU, there are two indications for this drug, stable angina and chronic heart failure. And regarding the PK, this drug is rapidly absorbed, the volume of distribution is substantial, the drug is moderately bound to plasma protein, and the blood-to-plasma ratio is about 0.7. The drug is mainly metabolized by T3A4, leading to an active metabolite, and the renal part represents 20% of the total clearance. The PK of the drug is linear with dose and time, and the PK-PD relationship between concentration of ibabradin and its main active metabolite and arthrite, the PD measurement, is known in adults. So initially, two indications were considered for ibabradin in children. One, to reduce arthrite when children have to undergo an angioscan, and one for children with chronic heart failure. For the first potential indication, the angioscan, the clinical pharmacokinetics and pharmacometrics group at Servier was involved in the dose selection and the sampling time optimization, and this work has been published in Clinical Pharmacokinetics. For the second potential indication, the cardiac heart failure, we were involved also in dose and sampling time determination, and this work has been published recently in GPKPD. So the first indication, the angioscan. So I suppose that everyone is now familiar with the FDA pediatric study decision 3. So for ibabradin, we were in the option B, where we had to conduct a PK-PD study to establish an exposure response in children for PD measurement, and to conduct a PK study to achieve target concentration based on the exposure response. So the study that we had to design was a dose-finding and tolerability study of ibabradin administered as an IV bolus for the heart rate control during angioscan in patients from 2 to 18 years old. And we were planning to enroll about 80 patients in 4 age classes, with 5 to 10 in the subset to 2 to 5 years old, and then 24 patients in each of the 3 other age classes. So the design of the, and the clinical constraints of this study were the following. So ibabradin was supposed to be administered as an IV bolus with a dose expressed as mg per kg. Due to the delay existing between the maximal concentration and the peak of effect, the angioscan was planned between 15 minutes and 1 hour and a half after dosing, with heart rate measurement every 15 minutes. And then children were supposed to stay at the hospital with heart rate measurement every hour, up to 5 hours after dosing, when they were allowed to go back at home. The dose-finding method for this trial was a bivariate conditional reassessment method, so the acronym is CRM, as published initially by O'Kinley in 2001 and then refined by Sarazoa in 2006. And the objective of such trial being to converge as soon as possible towards the right dose. However, to design a CRM, biostatisticians need a priori distribution of responders. So therefore, the contribution of the clinical PK and pharmacometric department was first to define the a priori distribution of responders in order to define the dose to be tested in the trial, and secondly, to determine the sampling time to assess the PK in children. So to define the a priori responder distribution, the strategy was to use the PBPK model previously developed in adults to predict the PK in children using the pediatric scaling module available in SimSit. So the model in adults was of course qualified for this purpose. So this means that we have verified its capability to predict PK in different conditions, such as drug-drug interaction study, to be sure of its Vmax and Km value for CYP3A4. As a pediatric tool, it helps us use antolinear cytochrome to predict the pK echelon. And then, the prediction of each age class were pulled together, and the joint parent metabolite for pK model was built with a non-name, including age and weight as covariates. So making the assumption that the PK-PD relationship should be the same between adults and children, the existing PK-PD model in adults was linked to the POP-PK model in children to simulate 1,000 times the study design, and that for a large range of doses. So to perform this simulation, we sample baseline heart rate values into the distribution of heart rate values at baseline in this population of children, and thresholds in terms of efficacy and safety for heart rate were determined after discussion between the clinician at Servier and the investigator. And from this simulation, the percentage of responder was defined for each dose. And this is what you have in the table on the right. So based on the distribution of responders over the dose range, biostatisticians at Servier were able to build the rules for the CRM, and the dose to be tested were defined. And thanks to this work, we convinced the clinician to allow the possibility into the protocol to test dose higher in children than the ones commonly used in adults. Okay. So the second part of our contribution was to optimize the sampling times for PK assessment. And the strategy was to use the POP-PK model developed thanks to the PBPK prediction to optimize the times of measurement using the software PFM. So initially, the proposal of the main investigator was to have 3 to 4 samples per child up to 5 hours after dosing, because then children were allowed to go back at home, and to avoid any PK samples before the image acquisition, because PK samples can increase the heart rate. And they didn't want at all PK in the group of young children, the one of from 2 to 5 years old. Sorry. So the strategy was to use design evaluation to show the impact of such limited design on the PK assessment in children. So to do that, we use PFIM, and the criterion was the deoptimality and the accuracy of parameter estimation. So first, we show that adding the last sample at least 10 hours after dosing allowed to reach a satisfactory level of accuracy of parameters of interest, like clearance. And this was not the case with the last sample at 6 or 8 hours. Then, we show that 24 hours was not really better than 10 hours for the last sample, with the risk of having a higher percentage of data below the limit of quantitation with the last sample at 24 hours. Then, we show that a minimum of 40 subjects out of the 80 with an additional sampling time at 10 hours post-dose allowed to get a satisfactory level of parameter estimation accuracy. And finally, we show that a sample at 5 minutes after dose was mandatory. So thanks to this work, we succeeded to convince the clinician and the main investigator to have 4 samples in each age class, with the earliest sample 5 minutes after dosing and the last 10 hours after dosing, with the nurse coming at home to make it. So the second potential indication for ibabradine was the chronic heart failure, And again, for this project, the contribution of my team was to help to the dose selection and the determination of the sampling time. So similarly to the previous example, we were in the case of option D with the need to conduct a PK/PD study to assess PK and then to conduct safety trial at the proper dose. So the study to design was a randomized, double-blind, multi-center, placebo-controlled finding study with PK/PD characterization and a one-year efficacy safety evaluation. And the population was pediatric patients with dilated cardiomyopathy and symptomatic chronic heart failure, aged from 6 months to less than 18 years old. And the plan being to include approximately 90 patients with 30 per age class. So the contribution of the clinical PK and pharmacometric department was to define the doses to be tested, and especially the starting dose and also the dose to use in the titration. And secondly, to determine the sampling time to assess the PK and shallot. So the strategy was to use the PBPK model previously developed in adults to adapt it to be able to predict the PK after oral administration of the drug with the pediatric formulation. So to do that, we have performed a relative bioavailability study in adults to compare the pediatric formulation and the marketed tablets in adults. The model was qualified for purpose, so we have compared the prediction to data with under different scenarios. And then, using the scaling module for pediatrics in SIMSIP, we predicted the PK profile of the drug in the different classes of age. And based on this prediction, we propose the starting dose and the following ones for the titration. So thus, the dose range used in adults for the titration was recommended for children as no major differences were anticipated between children and adults. Nevertheless, to be conservative, the starting dose was one level below the one in adults, as for the youngest we started even below with the lower dose pairing, as younger children could be higher exposed based on the PBPK prediction. And at last, as the PK/PD relationship being possibly different between adults and children, we propose to evaluate a higher dose per kid in children than the ones commonly used in adults. So here are the results of the clinical study in children. So on the graph, you can see the PBPK prediction in red and the observation in children as dots. And the agreement between prediction and observation was pretty good. And we confirm also that the youngest children are higher exposed when the dose is expressed per kg than the older children. Okay, so the second case study is about drug-drug interaction. So here, the study to design was an open monocentric study in healthy volunteers, where the objective was to assess the potential effect of repeated administration of the drug S, the perpetrator, on the PK of midazolam, a reference C2A4 substrate, following single oral administration. So here is displayed the design, so quite classical design for a drug-drug interaction study. So first administration of midazolam to get a reference, and then repeated administration of the perpetrator up to reach steady state. And at last, when the perpetrator is at steady state, the co-administration of the substrate and the perpetrator with a delay of 2 hours at the peak of concentration of the perpetrator was around 2 hours after dosing. And the objective here was to compare different sampling time design for PK assessment. So a full empirical one, as classically done in phase one, the optimal design for each drug separately, and the optimal design for both drugs with joint optimal sampling times. So for that, we use PBPK models for both drugs to simulate first the PK of each drug when administered separately, and then when co-administered. And this was done with SimSip. And on the right are the predicted PK profiles with, on the top, midazolam alone, so the grade A, and when co-administered with the drug S, the grade B, and on the bottom, the PK profile of drug S at steady state, the grade C. So these PK profiles, obtained thanks to the PBPK model, were analyzed then by POPPK modeling, and in order to obtain simple POPPK models, which were then used in POPDES to optimize the sampling times. So here are the results. So on the right, the optimal sampling times for each drug separately on the top, and for both drugs jointly on the bottom. And on the left, the comparison of performance of each design regarding clearance estimation. So we concluded that the joint optimal sampling design was doing an acceptable job. So for the study to come, a full empirical sampling time design was proposed, in which the optimal sampling times for both drugs were included, to be able at the end of the trial to assess their performance using real data. Nevertheless, we can already make the calculation that the multi-response optimal design can save 72 samples, which is maybe not the issue in healthy volunteers, but could be really interesting in such a study would have been performed in patients. So here are the comparison of the PBPK prediction and observation coming from the phase 1 drug-drug interaction study. So midazolam alone was well predicted, but the interaction was slightly under-predicted, as you can see from the graph on the bottom. And for drug S, the variability was overestimated, but the profile was acceptable. Observed data were analyzed by POPPK, using the different sampling times design, and parameter estimates were then compared, especially the clearance. So this global approach, including PBPK simulation, POPPK modeling, and multi-response optimal design, allowed without any in vivo data to design a clinical trial using sparse sampling, able to detect a PK interaction between two co-administered drugs. For both components, no statistical differences were observed between the apparent clearance estimates obtained with the two designs, so the empirical full design and the multi-response optimal design. And real-data analysis shows that the multi-response optimal design allowed to give the same conclusion, a factor 2 increase of the midazolam exposure when co-administered with the perpetrator, than the empirical full design. So this work has been published in GPKPD in 2008, and the approach could be of interest when the DDI study has to be performed in patients, so for example in oncology, or when we want to collect information about potential interaction between two drugs co-administered in a large trial in patients, for which we are limited in terms of samples. So to conclude this webinar, my take-home message is that PBPK prediction should be used more often to design clinical trials. And we can even go further and say that we could use PBPK prediction to learn about the drug and to design studies, and then to confirm the PK properties of the drug with in vivo data. These data allowing then to refine the PBPK model for the next step. And one of the examples is, for instance, the search of potential covariates. Maybe we should stop fishing covariates in phase 3, but confirmed using POP-PK approach the extrinsic and intrinsic factors influencing the PK based on PBPK prediction. This PBPK prediction allowing to design the phase 3 to be sure that we will have enough information to confirm effects of COVID. So optimal design approaches are implemented in free software and should be used more often to rationalize the design variable. And optimal design approaches are, I think, useful to teach about the impact of sampling times on a parameter estimate when discussing with non-pharmacometrician. So I would like to acknowledge Professor Leon Aons and Karen Gobero from the University of Manchester and Professor France Mantré and Cyril Dumont for the University Paris Diderot and all my colleagues at Cerier involved in the different case studies. So here are my mentors. So Professor Leon Aons, with who I started to learn about optimal design, and Professor France Mantré, with who I continue to learn about optimal design, and for PK and PBPK, Professor Malcolm Roland. And here is the pharmacometric group at Cerier.